Well, amen. Thank you, Miss Carmella. Let's give her a hand. Appreciate that good playing. Well, welcome back, students. Hope that your week is off to a great start in the classroom, and pray that you've seen God move in some mighty ways in the congregations that you were either participating in or that you were a part of this past weekend. We have with us today, he is no stranger to Clear Creek. Matter of fact, he's a graduate of Clear Creek, but Pastor Chad Fugitt, who serves at Central Baptist Church in Corbin, Kentucky, graduate of Clear Creek, a graduate also of the Southern Baptist Theological Seminary. He is married to Jennifer. They have two children, Caleb and Aubrey Grace. He has served as the president of the Pastors Conference of the Kentucky Baptist Convention. He has been nominated to be elected as president of the Kentucky Baptist Convention when this year's annual meeting rolls around in November. He will be voted on and I believe will be elected to serve and to represent Kentucky Baptist churches within the Kentucky Baptist Convention. And so we're thankful for his heart for the Lord. I know that he loves God. He loves to tell people about the good news of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, and his church is blessed as a result of his leadership. And so pray for him. We're thankful for him, and just pray God's blessings on him and his family. Travis Simpson is going to come and pray for us today, and after he prays, we'll get into worshiping the Lord. How many loves Christ? Amen. Amen. How many's thankful they're saved?
Amen.
Come on, Travis.
Good morning. We have one prayer request, a girl named Cassie. She's 15 years old, and the request says she does not want to live. So let's go to the Lord in prayer and pray for this young lady. Gracious Heavenly Father, we approach your throne of grace this morning to thank you for waking us from our sleep and allowing us to be here as a body to pour our hearts out to you in worship and to adore who you are and what you've done for us through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we lift up Cassie to you this morning, who is no longer wants to live. But Lord, we pray that your Spirit would minister to her, that you would send saints of God to give her godly counsel, that Lord, you would turn her heart to see, Lord, that there is hope and that there is redemption in Christ and a reason to move forward in this life. Lord, let her find her purpose and reason for living, Lord, that she may impact your kingdom. Father, I pray that our worship this morning would be sweet to you and acceptable through your Son, to whom we offer it. And I pray that you'd be with Brother Chad as he opens the word. And we pray all these things in the name of Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, Clear Creek. Let's stand together and worship our Savior.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory. Who rules the nations with truth and justice? Shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. All that you've done for me. Christ is my reward and all of my devotion. Now there's nothing in this world that could ever satisfy. Through every trial, my soul will sing, no turning back. I've been set free. Christ is enough for me. Christ is enough for me. Everything I need is in you. Everything I joy of my salvation, and this hope will never fail, 'cause heaven is our home. Through every storm, my soul will sing, Jesus is here, to God be the glory.
Sing it out, church.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. The cross before me. the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. The cross before me, the world behind me. No turning back, no turning back. Christ is enough for me. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back.
Amen. Give the Lord praise today, church. Thank you, Lord. And I do pray that that's our heart's cry today, is not only this campus, but as Christians, that Christ is enough for us. That no matter what we're going through, whatever our circumstances, at the end of the day, if we are truly saved, Christ is enough for us. And we need to share that message with as many as possible. And so now I invite you during this time, if God's laying someone on your heart that needs to hear that, I pray you take this time we're about to have in prayer just to cry out to God on their behalf this morning. Just like that young lady individual that Travis mentioned in his prayer, just to pray for her fervently. So now join me in this time, whether sitting, standing, or coming to this altar, let's cry out to God.
Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, whoever lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hand. No tongue can despair and tells me of the guilt within. Of word I look and see him there, the day went to all my sin, because the sin. My Savior and my God. I bow before the cross of Christ and marvel at this love divine. God's perfect Son was sacrificed to make me righteous.
Thank you, Lord, this morning. Lord, as we come before you, before that throne, Lord, help us always remember that when we gather as the body of Christ, Lord, with the Holy Spirit's in our heart, Lord, when he is the one that intercedes for us on behalf of Jesus' blood, Lord, to you, Lord, help us have that image in our mind, God, that you don't see the filthy rags, Lord, because you say the best we can offer is filthy rags, but God, you look at it through the eyes of Jesus and his blood. Lord, we thank you for that. So, Lord, I pray that every time we gather, Lord, we will remember that. And as we enter in this time of worship through your word, Lord, help us, Lord, hear the words of Jesus, Lord, that we may go out and share them with the world and the multitudes. And, God, we thank you in advance for all that you're going to do in each and every one of our lives, Lord, for your glory and yours alone. So bless us now as we begin this time of worship through your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
It's an honor to stand behind this sacred desk. Can't tell you all the number of sermons that I've heard preached from this desk. Turned my tag very faithfully every Tuesday and Thursday. And I recognize today that you are here, and that's a good thing. It's better that you're here than that you're not here. So I'm grateful that you're here today. And I'm praying that God will use his word today to have some effect upon your soul and on my soul today as the word of God comes to bear on all of our lives. And so with that in mind, I want to invite you to turn to 2 Peter chapter 1. 2 Peter chapter 1. Title of the message this morning is The Word-Directed Ministry. The Word-Directed Ministry. I just want to say, how thankful I am for this school. I'm so thankful for Dr. Fox and his leadership of Clear Creek and the professors and everyone that's making the difference that they're making in all of your lives here. The difference that's been made in my life because of Clear Creek. So grateful for the time that God gave me here, and very humbled to be here today to share. In 2 Peter chapter 1, I want to begin reading with verse 16. For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. But we were eyewitnesses of His majesty. For when He received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to Him by the majestic glory, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased," we ourselves heard this very voice born from heaven. We were with Him on the holy mountain. And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. No prophecy was ever produced by the will of man. But men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Father, we pray You would bless the reading of Your Word and the preaching that comes hereafter. May You be glorified in our lives and our ministries. This is our prayer in Christ's name. Amen. Nicholas Copernicus was a scholar who lived a quiet life as a canon in the Catholic Church in the late 1400s and early 1500s. He studied mathematics and all the classical languages, but as time went by, he became more and more captured by the concept of the stars. He became more fascinated with astrology. And quietly, he made maybe the most astounding observation in the entire history of this science. He asserted that the earth was not the center of the universe. Rather, he asserted that the earth rotated on its axis once daily and traveled around the sun once yearly. An astounding concept for the time, given the reality that his assertion was made without the aid of a telescope, which wouldn't be even invented for another 100 years. You see, prior to this time, everyone asserted and everyone believed in the teachings of a man named Ptolemy. Ptolemy's findings were that the earth was a fixed, inert, immovable mass located at the center of the universe, and all celestial bodies, including the sun and the fixed stars, revolved around the earth, and that it was a theory that appealed to human nature. It fit with the casual observations that a person might want to make in the field. And second, it fed man's ego. Everything revolves around the earth. Everything revolves around us. You see, although Copernicus never lived to see the effects of his teaching, he had started a revolution. The Copernican Revolution. And I want to say this morning that I really believe that same kind of revolution needs to happen in the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ today. You see, in the church, we have so many people who are walking around who are saying that they are following Jesus Christ When in fact, if you look at their lives, if you look at their checkbooks, if you look at where they live and where they go and where they're not, they're showing the world that really Christ is not the center of who they are, but really they are the center of their world. Well, folks, I've got news for them, and I've got news for you, and I've got news for me today. We are not the center of the universe. Jesus Christ, our Lord, is the one to whom everything centers around. Everything that God has made, He made it around Him. The Bible says all things are from Him, and all things are through Him, and all things are going back to Him. But I have to say, in this epidemic of egocentric living in the church, it does not start with the people. Rather, it starts with the pastors. It starts with the ministers. We are feeding the church this line of malarkey. We are doing this. You say, Chad, how could you say that we are doing this? Feeding folks with self-esteem messages. Feeding people with topical sermons, feeding them with messages that are all about them and all about their life and five ways to this and seven ways to that. All that is doing is feeding the monster that is already in the local church. All that is doing is feeding the monster that's killing the church of the Lord Jesus Christ today, and that is the monster of pride and self-centeredness. Well, sooner or later, our people are going to have to come up against what I call ultimate questions in life, like how are they going to handle the call when they're told that cancer is attacking and killing their body? How are they going to deal with the prospect of death? How are they going to find true meaning and purpose in life? I can tell you this morning that the world of self-centeredness and pride has no answers for questions like these. Answers for these questions, true answers, come only from one place, and that is the Word of God. This is the only place that we can find the answers to the ultimate questions in life. To make Jesus a central reality, though, in the lives of our people, we must allow the Bible to direct our ministries. What I am pulling for this morning in your heart, what I'm asking God to do in your lives today, and what I'm asking Him to do in my life every day as a minister of the gospel is simply this. I want to be more consumed with the Word of God today than I was yesterday. I want to be more consumed with Jesus in His Word this year than I was last year. I want my life to be so consumed with a passion for the Word of God that it cannot help but ooze out into the lives of my people as well. So today, there are three imperatives that I want to pull really from verse 19, but we'll look at the surrounding text as well, because a text without a context is a pretext for a proof text. So we need to see these three imperatives today. First of all, we need to see the glory of Christ in the Word. See the glory of Christ in the Word. We must see this as ministers of the gospel, or our people will never see this. In other words, if you don't see Christ's glory in this book, your people will never see it. And so, as we think about this, Peter begins this text by telling a story. It's a true story. It's a story that he himself experienced. He's drawing back on his ministries of following Jesus for 3.5 years. He's drawing back on his eyes and his ears and his experience with the Lord. And he's drawing back to a moment that he saw with his own eyes and heard with his own ears that few mortals had ever seen or ever heard themselves. Peter was an eyewitness to an event known as the Transfiguration. And that's really what he's talking about here in the beginning of this passage. The Bible says in John 1:14, for example, that we have seen His glory. Oh, and there's so many ways in which Jesus reveals His glory in the Bible. I mean, we see His glory in that He teaches the true Word. We see His glory in the creative miracles that He performs by healing the sick. We see His glory in His death on the cross. We see His glory in the resurrection from the dead. We see His glory, but the transfiguration is something different, because in the transfiguration, we literally see the glory of Christ. This is an amazing thing. Matter of fact, I just want to take a moment and I've turned back over here to Matthew 17. And I just want you to listen. If you have a Bible, read with me, but just listen to this account. Matthew 17, verse 1. And after 6 days, Jesus took with Him Peter and James and John, His brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves, and He was transfigured before them. Metamorphosis. This is the term that's used here. And His face shone like the sun, and His clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with Him. What in the world? And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is a good thing that we're here. If You wish, I'll make 3 tents here, one for You and one for Moses and one for Elijah." And as He was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed them, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is My beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to Him." And when His disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and they peed their pants. No, it didn't say that, but that's probably what happened. They fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Rise and have no fear." And when they lifted their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. What an amazing account. What an amazing description. Jesus here, the descriptions of Him as being bright as the sun and His clothes being white as light, they mirror the descriptions that the apocalyptic descriptions that that Daniel says about Him and Daniel's prophetic work, and they mirror the apocalyptic pictures of Him in Revelation as well. This is where the glory of Jesus Christ is on full display. It's almost like all of the glory that was internally in the Lord Jesus Christ is fully on display, so that everyone who is there could see His glory fully on display. For me, this is easily in the top 5 of the scenes that I want to watch on heavenly DVR one of these days. I mean, I want to go into the DVR room in heaven. Lord, I want You to bring up for me the transfiguration. I want to see that, because that would be an amazing sight to see. But now you turn back with me to 2 Peter chapter 1. And I want you to notice what Peter says about this spectacular event. Notice this. This is fascinating to me. He said, "We didn't follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of His majesty. For when He received honor and glory from God the Father and the voice was borne to Him by the majestic glory, 'This is My beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased,' we overheard this very voice born from heaven, for we were with Him on the holy mountain." Wow, right? Like, he's saying, we were right there. We witnessed this transfiguration. This is the greatest thing anyone could ever see. It's the greatest experience anyone could ever have. And yet, now, look at the very beginning of verse 19 and notice what he says here. Oh. "And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed." You know what he's saying here?
The prophetic word here is a reference to the written word of God. And what is Peter saying? What is he saying about the words that you're holding in your hands this morning? If you're holding a treasured copy of the word of God in your heart this morning, your arms and your hands this morning, he's saying that the glory of Christ is more clearly seen on the pages of Holy Scripture than it is with his own eyes and his own ears. What is he saying? He's saying that the Word of God gives us a more clear picture of the glory of Jesus Christ than his own eyes and his own ears did in the experience of viewing the transfiguration. The prophetic word is more clearly viewed. So the word is paramount to experience. The word is paramount to experience. Yeah. Yeah. You might say, well, how can you say that? Well, first of all, I'm not saying that. God's word is saying that. Remember, in Psalm 138, verse 2, the Bible says, "For you have exalted above all things your name and your word." God carries the same level of holiness, the same level of gravity for his word as he does his very holy name. You cannot exalt the word of God high enough. But second, I'm not downgrading your experiences with God. Don't hear me saying that experiences aren't important. Let me tell you something. If you surrender your life to the Lord Jesus Christ and you begin to walk with him and abide with him daily, you're going to begin to experience God in ways that you never would apart from that. I mean, you're going to see him in ways. You're going to hear him in ways. You're going to watch him doing miraculous things in your life. But I'm not downgrading that. This is what I'm saying. How can you know that that is the work of God in your life? Only by looking at the Word of God. You see, the wondrous experiences that we have in our daily lives must be matched to a question. How do you know it was God that you've experienced? It's only when your experience lines up with the truth and the glory that's found in this book. So you see this morning, all I'm saying is that so many people are out there and they're looking for more in their experience with God. They're looking for some kind of ultra great experience or some sort of mystical experience with God. And they want to know him more. They want to see him more. And they sing of this and they talk of this. And I just want to say, nonsense. If you want to experience God, get up in the morning. Open the Bible. Read the book. Because the glory of Christ is in this word more sure than any experience that you will ever have in your life. Open the fathomless, infinite Word of God. Start reading the Bible. Open your eyes to His glory that we behold right here in this book. You see, you'll never have a Word-directed ministry until you find the glory of God in His Word. Peter's saying it here for you. I'm telling you, it is here for you. There is a gospel feast that God has waiting for us every moment of every day. And the only thing that's keeping you back from the hunger that's truly dwelling in your soul is just you shutting everything out, opening up the Word of God, and feasting on the words of this great book. Now, the truth is, and you need to listen to me here, this is coming out of 20 years of pastoral ministry experience. Can't believe that. But it's true. I've been doing this for 20 years now. I can't believe it, Dr. Diddy. I feel like I should be in your hermeneutics class on Thursday night. Listen, you can never lead your people to a place you've never been yourself. If you don't have a passion for the Word of God, you cannot expect a passion from your people for the Word. If this book doesn't fire your soul, it's not going to fire their souls. If it's cold in the pulpit, it's frigid in the pews. So what I'm saying is, we have got to see the glory of God in our lives, and then and only then will your people see it in their lives. We've got to be moved by this word, or our people will never be moved by it. So we need to see the glory of Christ in the word. Secondly, we need to allow the word to guide us. Allow the word to guide us. Now, look at verse 19 again. He says there, and we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed. Now, look, notice this, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place. Now, Peter is saying here that we would do well to give careful attention to the content of this book. Why? Well, I can tell you because we're going to be judged for the contents of this book. Even you all are going to be judged by the contents of this book. You're going to stand before God one day and give an account. As a matter of fact, James chapter 3, verse 1 says, not many of you should become teachers. Not many of you should become teachers, my brothers, for you know that we who teach will be judged with greater strictness. So you need to understand, not only should you know the word because you're going to be judged, but you're going to be judged more strictly because you're teaching the word. So if you're going to teach the word, you should know the word. But we shouldn't just pay attention to the words of this book because its contents will be the contents by which we will be judged. But we should pay attention to this book because its contents literally transform our lives. And its contents are the only contents that can transform the lives of our people. This is why we need a word-driven ministry. Because only the word can transform people's lives. So, we find this all throughout the scripture. But the chief place where we behold the glory of Jesus in his words and we're transformed that glory is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 18. And we all with unveiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. For this comes from the Lord who is the Spirit. So Peter's telling us here in verse 19, he's telling us that the Bible is like a lamp in a dark place. It's like a lamp in a dark place. Now, the word dark, akmuros, is a morbid word. Matter of fact, I think it's only used here in the New Testament. I might be wrong. It means dry. It means parched, dirty, or murky. And it's a picture of the world that we live in today. Amos the prophet said it like this. The prophet Amos said in Amos 8:11, "Behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord God, when I will send a famine on the land, not a famine of bread, nor of thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord." Brothers and sisters, we are living in these days now. There is a famine in the land for the word of God. We live in a dry, parched, dirty, murky world. Folks, there's a famine in the land, and it's a famine for God's word. But in the midst of this famine, you and you alone hold the nourishment for life, the Bible. In the midst of this dark world that we're living in, you and you alone are holding out the light for your people. The light is the word of God. We need to get back to the days where we recognize that as pastors, we have the Spirit of God living within us. We have the calling of God placed upon us. And we wield the sword of the Word of God and that alone. We need to come to a place where the Spirit and the calling and the Word is all we have. But praise God, we recognize it's all we need. Amen. So what is our focus. Why are we focusing so much on the Word of God, on the Bible? Because it is a lamp. Psalm 119, your Word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. We solely focus on this book because it is the lamp and it's all you need to get from one place to another. Allow this book to guide you and it will transform you as you're directed by the Word. I'm telling you, it will transform not only your heart and your life, it'll transform your ministry, and in doing so, it will transform the lives of your people. Now, I want you to listen to what our folks, our poor people at Central Baptist Church in Corbin, have heard about in the past month on Sunday mornings. This has been what they've had to learn about. Our insufficiencies to deal with the troubles of this life. Only our sufficiency can come from Christ. The necessity of serving the Lord in daily life. The power to overcome temptation in daily living. How to understand marriage and divorce and the implications of both for our lives. The radical nature of finding salvation in Jesus Christ. I just gave you 5 bullet points of the last 5 sermons I preached on Sunday morning. And you say, wow, man, that was relevant. Pastor Chad, it was kind of cool. How'd you come up with that? Why'd you decide to preach on that stuff? I didn't. Let me just say this too. When you're dealing with a culture where 50% of all marriages end in divorce, you don't pick a Sunday morning to stand up and talk about marriage and divorce. But here's the deal. I didn't choose those texts. I didn't choose those topics. What I did was I prayerfully sought God, and God said, Chad, I want you to preach the gospel of Mark. And what you just heard, those topics just flowed directly out of verse-by-verse preaching through the gospel of Mark. And all of that I just talked about is found in Mark chapter 9 and chapter 10. Now, do you know where we err? We err as pastors and ministers today in thinking that we know what our people need to hear more than God knows what our people need to hear. We err when we think we've got it figured out what we need to preach and what we need to do and what we need to say. Brothers and sisters, that could not be any further from the truth. This is the glory of expositional preaching. This is the glory of preaching verse by verse, text by text through the Bible, that you end up preaching the whole counsel of God. You know, I didn't choose to preach on marriage and divorce. It was the next text. I didn't choose to talk about how we're insufficient to do the daily task of our lives. That was the next text. I didn't choose to teach our people how they need to be serving with humility and serving for eternity and being faithful in service to the church. No. Jesus chose that. That was just right there out of the text. And you see, our people need to hear these truths, and God knows it, but our people also know. I'm not picking on anybody, right? It's not like Pastor Chad got up there and started preaching on divorce because he had an heir to pick with someone that's got a divorce. No. They know that I preached that text because that was the next text. And they knew it was difficult for me to do it. And they heard me preach it in a pastoral manner. And they heard me struggling as I was preaching God's truth to them. But the fact of the matter is that preaching week to week in a pastoral manner means that we preach the Word of God. We don't need preaching that comes from our favorite topics every week. You know why? Because you've got about 5 favorite topics and you'll preach them over and over and over and over again. And about 20 weeks, your folks are going to be sick and tired of hearing about your favorite topics. They'll be able to preach your sermons better than you. They don't need that. They don't need some cute sermonites every week that's sort of playing off of popular culture or some movie that you watch. That's hogwash. No, we are preaching the Bible. We're preaching the whole counsel of God. And in doing so, we're building a life in a church that will stand the test of time, because we're not building on the slippery foundations of this world. We're not building on the slippery foundations of self-esteem. We're not building on your best life now by Joel Osteen or something. We're building on the solid rock of the Word of God. So let the Word guide you. And then third, very quickly, yearn for the second coming. Now, this seems weird. How does yearning for the second coming, what does that have to do with a word-driven ministry? Well, look at verse 19 again. And we have the prophetic word more fully confirmed, to which you will do well to pay attention as to a lamp shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. What is Peter saying here? He is speaking of the second coming of the Lord Jesus Christ. The morning star is the Lord Jesus Himself, who is coming again. And what does Peter say is propelling him until that day? It was not his viewing of Jesus in the Transfiguration, which was a precursory viewing of the second coming of Christ. No, it is the Word of God that was pushing him until that day. It was this confirmed Word that is pushing him to this day. You might ask the question, what does yearning for the second coming have to do with giving your life to a Word-directed ministry? Well, it is simply this. The promise of this book is that by reading it, your heart will be transformed. And the hearts of your people will be transformed through the preaching and the teaching of it. That's what we read in 2 Corinthians earlier. But what do we find? This is what we find. No matter how much I give myself to this book, here's what I find. I find there are more and more layers of unbelief and more layers of things in me that do not reflect the glory of Jesus. So I must constantly come back to the Word, because as I grow in Christ, the more I find how little I have grown in Christ. As I learn the Word, the more ignorant I become of the Word. Have you noticed this in your classes yet? The longer I took Dr. Diddy, the more I learned. But the more he taught me, the more I realized how little I knew. This is Bible college. This is seminary. This is how it works. The more you dive into this book, the deeper you dive, the more you see how shallow your understanding is. It's frustrating, because the more I grow in holiness, the more I learn that I need to grow in holiness more and more. And oh, can we grow frustrated with ourselves, but how we can also grow very frustrated with the people that we pastor as well. I mean, if you're a pastor and you're being a true pastor, a man of God, doing life with your folks, you will be walking with them in life as a shepherd walks with his sheep. Now, walk with me here. Sometimes, this is what we realize about these sheep that we're walking with. Our sheep stink. Hello. They smell bad. They look so dirty, because they roll around in the field and they are smelly and they're stinky and they're dirty. They stink so bad and they smell so bad. But get this, we're walking with them, and what happens? In our discouragement looking at their filthiness, here we are walking with them, and guess what? In our discouragement, we start to smell and stink like our sheep. When the Bible's saying, listen, this is life. This is pastoral ministry. You cannot roll up your sleeves in pastoral ministry and not get muddy in the world that we're called to serve. You hear that? You can't walk with people who are walking through addiction and not feel the pain of addiction. You cannot walk with a couple who's going through a divorce and not feel the pain of separation and the pain of divorce. You cannot walk with a couple who's dealing with a rebellious teenager and not feel their pain as a father feels pain for the child. But the second coming, the second coming offers us the ultimate realization of our faith. We will never be perfect in this world. We'll never be fully conformed to the image of Christ in this life. There'll never be a day in the church that you pastor where there will not be troubles, where there will not be an adversary, where there will not be an enemy who will be coming for you and coming for your people. But, the Bible says there is a time coming in verse 19 when the day will dawn and the morning star will rise in our hearts. Then I will be made like Him. Then my people will be made like Him. Then my life and their life will look fully like Christ's life. Then the limitations of sin will be completely gone. We will love Him fully. We will reflect Him fully. We will be like Him fully. That is the day that we have to minister with now. We have to have that in mind. Not the filth that we see now. Oh, but the trophy of grace that God is making out of that mess. A word-directed ministry means we are feeding on the glory of Christ ourselves, and we're seeing His glory, and we're allowing the Word to guide and direct us in our lives, but we're doing that knowing there's coming a day when the darkness of this world will be pushed aside. There's coming a day when all the wrongs of this world will be made right. There's coming a day when Christ will rule and reign forever, and we will reign with Him. Can I pray with you as we close? Father, we love You, and we love Your Word, but we do not love it as we ought. But, oh God, we pray in these areas of our lives where we don't love Your Word as we should, where we're not as consumed as we should be. I pray that You would consume us there. I pray for those of us who are distracted by other things. Oh, Father, please, please let us see those distractions as what they are, a distraction from You, a distraction from Your Word. Fill our hearts with passion for You. Allow Your Word to direct everything in our lives, especially, Lord, our ministry. Lord, let us build our ministries not on the transient ways of this world, but on the fixed glory of Your Word. Help us to see that years and years and years of ministry are fruitful, not when we're relevant, but when we look to the timeless relevance of Your unchanging, immutable Word. Lord, we love You, we praise You, we ask You to guide and lead us as we go from this place now. We pray all this in the powerful name of Jesus.